here. A few announcements. Feedback@shmoocon.org. Please send us emails. Let us know what you liked. Let us know where we could improve. We take every bit of feedback to heart, and we really care about the community. The reason we started Shmoocon in the first place is we wanted to make the community better. We thought things could be done in a better way, and we really do take every bit of feedback you provide us and try and make the conference a better place. So please, if you thought a talk was great, we'll pass that feedback on. If you have constructive criticism to a speaker, we can pass that on too. So again, feedback@shmoocon.org. After this talk, this room will close down and we will have our final closing plenary in the main room. That will be, we'll be talking about the competition framework team, the team that built the framework for DARPA's Cyber Grand Challenge that happened this year at DEF CON. We'll be doing a presentation. After that, we will have our closing remarks. When closing remarks starts, registration will close. So you will no longer be able to acquire the cool t-shirts from this year or bags or whatnot. Again, we have shirts that are still available for donation. They're a $15 donation to one of three very worthy charities. I'm sure you all are very familiar with Hackers for Charity, as well as the EFF. This year, we have a new charity, Child's Play, childsplaycharity.org. Their goal in life is to make children who are in hospitals or in domestic violence shelters their lives better. Those children are in a pretty terrible place, so they give them video games and try and make their lives better while they're going through some pretty horrific stuff. So please, if you have the opportunity, go make a donation. You'll get a t-shirt in reward. With that, we also have DVDs available for sale of all of the talks that you've seen, as well as the closing session will also be available on DVD. Ted, you have to pass them to get out of the conference. Those are available for sale up until the end of the day. With that, I have a few things to give out. Again, these are not just stress balls. If you think this presenter or other presenters are full of crap, stand up and throw a ball. Let them know. You don't just have to stand up and call out. This is a visceral way of letting the speakers know if you don't agree with them. Of course, they have the opportunity to throw them back.
Yes.
I have no moose, but I do have something sharp that will hurt when it hits you. So hopefully everybody's woken up. So this is a pre-solved Rubik's Cube. So for those of you unable to solve a Rubik's Cube, this one's solved already.
Yeah. Do not throw the Rubik's Cube
and
at the speaker.
Have some t-shirts. These t-shirts are available as a reward for donations, so please, 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 please go donate to some very worthy charities. Wow, such violence for a t-shirt. If you have that much violence in your heart, go donate some more money to these charities. All right, so there's a lot of people standing in the back. Please, there's more seats available. Pretend like you like each other. So guys, if you're gonna come watch the talk, please come in. There's plenty of seats available in the middle. Pretend like you like people. You come to conferences, not just for the talks, but also the social experience. So get social. So while the last set of... While the last set of people are getting seated, I would like please give a warm welcome to a talk that I am sure plenty of people really want to see, and the internet is probably thriving to watch. We want to hear all about, did Russia actually impact our election? So please give a warm welcome to our next presenter.
Great. Good afternoon. Can you guys hear me okay? Excellent. You know, I have to admit, when I first saw the schedule and saw that I was going to be presenting Sunday afternoon, it's like, man, no one's going to come for this talk. Like, everyone's going to be hungover from the party the night before.
Surprise.
I know. Yeah, exactly. Of course, I didn't appreciate that those were not mutually exclusive outcomes. So, well done. Welcome. Thank you for coming. My name is Toni Gidwani. I am the Director of Research Operations at Threat Connect. We are a provider of a threat intelligence platform, but that's not really what I'm here to talk about today. Our research team is power users of our platform, does all sorts of cool stuff. In a lot of ways, this presentation is kind of what Threat Connect did on our summer vacation. We picked up this story because we thought it was interesting, and every time we tried to put it down, it pulled us back in. But I think we did some really worthwhile work, and you know, this is my first Shmoocon, so I humbly submit these findings to the group here. And without further ado, so today we're going to walk through a series of events that started with the announcement of the DNC breach in June, progressing up through the fall. And as I go through this talk, you know, there are a couple things that I want you to keep in mind, that we're going to be talking about what is essentially a 1-2 punch of different operations to breach and exfiltrate data and then leak that data onto the internet for public consumption. So keep that in mind as we walk through these different initiatives that both of these came together in what turned out to be a pretty surprising campaign that I don't think a lot of us expected, even though I thought, you know, a lot of us were braced for just about anything going to this election cycle. This one still surprised a lot of us. So we'll start with the DNC breach. We'll walk through some of the entities that were created to get this content out for public consumption, and then wrap up with some of our conclusions about sort of lessons learned in conducting this type of analysis, where we think this is going, and so on. So, start with a little bit of basics. We're basically going to be talking today about two threat actor groups called Fancy Bear and Cozy Bear. Now, many of you are probably aware, within the InfoSec industry, different companies have different names for these threat actors. It makes all of our lives a little bit more complicated. We at Threat Connect are not going to add to that confusion by throwing out yet another moniker for these groups. The world doesn't really need that. So we're going to go with the CrowdStrike names of Fancy Bear and Cozy Bear, since it was their incident response research findings from the DNC breach that sort of kicked this off. And also because it means I get to use graphics of a bear wearing a bow tie and a monocle, which is so much more fun than I usually get to have with PowerPoint. So starting on the left there, Fancy Bear, alternately known as APT28 or SOFACY, the malware family they were originally sort of identified around, extensively targets defense ministries, military-related victims, also more heavily and traditionally seen in Europe than here in the U.S. Got some custom implants there in malware families, including SOFACY, X-Agent, X-Tunnel. X-Agent and X-Tunnel will show up in the DNC breach itself. And a heavy reliance on stealing victim credentials by spoofing web-based email services, which is also a very prominent theme in our story here today. Some of their greatest hits, they've been publicly linked before to intrusions in the German parliament, as well as France's TB5 Monde. On the right side of the slide, you see Cozy Bear, also known as Cozy Duke or APT29. Their target set's much more wide-ranging than just traditional defense-related victims. They target in a range of verticals of strategic interest, including defense, energy, the financial sector, manufacturing, companies across those spheres. A much heavier reliance on using remote access tools like Adobe ARM or ATI Agent in their attacks, as opposed to the email harvesting method that Fancy Bear likes to use. They use the spearfish campaigns with links to a malicious dropper. Oftentimes, those malicious droppers and the payload will be very non-cooperative in sandbox environments for researchers. They've been linked to intrusions into the unclassified networks of the White House, the State Department, and the U.S. Joint Chiefs of Staff. I was leaving the Department of Defense, and there was some press about this summer, where the intrusion into the Joint Chiefs of Staff took that network down hard for several weeks to make sure they fully cleaned up the intrusion. All right, so having laid our foundation, let's get straight to it. This story started for us at Threat Connect the way it did for most of us when the Washington Post published an article on the 14th of June saying that the DNC had been massively hacked. And this was really interesting because the DNC, in an attempt to sort of draw the sting of what had happened, decided to go public with the story of the intrusion and allowed CrowdStrike to publish their technical analysis and share indicators with the community. And this really becomes critically important to the way events unfolded over the summer because it energized and engaged a whole range of researchers across a number of companies and, you know, research organizations to get involved in this story, to validate those findings and expand upon them. In a world in which the DNC didn't do that, and the first time we started talking about this was when WikiLeaks dumped thousands of emails in late July, this unfolds very differently. Nobody's had time to really process what's going on and to find other clues to continue the trail. So, what CrowdStrike found was that both of these threat actors had breached the DNC, and that there was no evidence that either group knew the other was there. For those of us that have come out of a background working, you know, with a Western intelligence agency, like, that seems absurd that you would have two guys on the same team mucking up each other's operations because they didn't deconflict what target they were going to hit. But this is actually not uncommon, particularly for the Russians, because of the competitive dynamic within their government and their intelligence agencies. So researchers have often found multiple Russian threat actors hitting a same target. So the DNC breach itself. Start with Fancy Bear. Fancy Bear is really who most of this presentation is about. They were the more recent entry into the DNC network. They breached in April of 2016. The X-Agent and X-Tunnel tools were found on the networks, and as well as employing those anti-forensic measures. So it's really interesting. This seems to be the noisier threat actor, because shortly after Fancy Bear breached, this is when the DNC realized that something was amiss and called in CrowdStrike. By contrast, Cozy Bear breached in the summer of 2015. Using a CDaddy implant that was developed in Python and a PowerShell backdoor that was stored only in the WMI database. And if you read CrowdStrike's technical analysis, which I highly recommend, they're almost glowing in terms of the simplicity and elegance of this PowerShell backdoor that was used in the DNC attack. It allowed the attackers to download additional modules on, you know, timing of their choosing, and allowed them to execute from memory in a very low observable fashion. And so it kind of stands to reason, if it had just been Cozy Bear, there's a really good chance this breach might have gone completely undetected. That it wasn't until Fancy Bear kind of came stomping in and breaking things that people realized that there was a problem here. So that's the starting point. We read this, we think it's really cool. And so meanwhile, back at Threat Connect, we're taking a look at this analysis and saying, you know, this is pretty interesting stuff. So we do what we do. We upload those indicators into our platform and see what else we can find. We shared it out, so this CrowdStrike's analysis was available to all of our users, and we started to hunt. And what we found when we went and looked at one of the command and control nodes was something really interesting. So quick show of hands, how many of you are familiar with or have used passive DNS before? All right. Yes, thank you all my Threat Connect people for raising your hands. So passive DNS is a powerful tool for a researcher. These data sets, the companies that maintain them, have sensors that collect resolutions over time between domains and IP addresses. So when you're looking at malicious infrastructure, which of course is very transient and easy for an attacker to switch out, this provides the researcher with a really useful tool in your kit to gain a retrospective understanding of what's happened on this infrastructure over time. So we went and looked at this IP address that CrowdStrike had identified as one of the Fancy Bear C2 nodes in the DNC attack, and we found something that looked like a domain spoof, this MIS department with the T and the R flipped in the middle of the domain name. So, you know, passive DNS is a tool that we use a lot. We then proceeded to use one of researchers' other favorite tools, Google, to take a look at and see what MIS department was. And lo and behold, we found that the MIS department is an IT services provider for the DNC and other Democratic-related campaigns and clients. So this is now extremely interesting. This is exactly the type of organization that you would seek to impersonate an attack like this. This would be, you know, unusual to see call-outs to your IT services provider on your network. And so a great type of organization to spoof if you're an attacker. So now we're pretty sure we're on to something here, that this is significant. So we dig a little farther, see what else we can find out about this MIS department site. fake MIS department site. So we take a look at the WHOIS registration information, and in this case, the registrant information wasn't even obscured. We didn't have to dig any further for it. We found it was registered out of Paris, France, by a throwaway email address, frankmerdu@europe.com. So at this point, we didn't realize that this was going to become a trend that we were going to see pop up repeatedly over the course of our research, that there are a lot of times this infrastructure was being registered with a France-based Nexus, and that Fancy Bear likes to use these disposable email addresses from services like @europe.com and @mail.com, both of which are provided by a company called 1&1, a free webmail service. And you'll see as we go throughout the presentation that these email addresses of @europe.com and @mail.com keep popping up. So far, so good. We feel like we're, expanding upon CrowdStrike's findings, and, the DNC's been hit. That's not great for America, but, foreign countries are going to hack, politicians. That's like a legitimate intelligence target as much as we don't like it. But then, something weird happened. This guy shows up, Guccifer 2.0. The next day, on 15 June, a WordPress site emerges. And then a couple days later, a Twitter account is created. So this is literally the least amount of work you can put into creating a persona on the internet. And he comes out and he says, it wasn't Fancy Bear and Cozy Bear. That CrowdStrike is wrong. I did it. I was the one that hacked the DNC. I'm motivated to create a world free from Illuminati. That is a direct quote. I did not make that up. That I hacked the DNC in the summer of 2015. I have no affiliation with Russia. I'm Romanian. I'm an independent hacker. And so this happens, and we're all sitting around going, well, something stinks here. This does not make any sense at all. And so Guccifer 2.0 starts posting, these purloined documents on his WordPress site, and then engaging with journalists. So he's conducting interviews. He's having chat sessions with them. He's pushing out documents also, sort of point to point via different journalists. So we're looking at this and trying to figure out what is going on here. Is this guy the hacktivist that he claims to be, or is this basically a state-sponsored fake-tivist? Is this a front for the Russians to try and draw attention away from the fact that they have just been outed for a massive hack of a politically sensitive target during the middle of an election? And so when we started looking at this, we knew right away that Guccifer's claims that Fancy Bear and Cozy Bear had not hacked the DNC were rubbish. We had the technical evidence that showed that these threat actors had been found on the networks. That didn't necessarily preclude a third independent hacker had also breached the DNC networks. And so we sat down and we did a traditional analysis of competing hypotheses. For those of you who are familiar with the technique, it's one used by the intelligence agencies. You can Google it. It's unclassified because it's not a technical technique. It's cognitive. It's a way for you to check your biases and weigh your evidence to see if you're latching on to the argument you want to be true as opposed to where the evidence is leading you. So it's a really powerful check. As you work through problems like this where, you're very much weighted to one side. And we definitely were. We were pretty convinced that Guccifer 2.0 was a Russian fake-tivist. But, we have to do due diligence here. So we sat down and we stacked up all of our evidence in terms of what's the best case I can make that this guy is, in fact, an independent hacktivist, and can I disprove that? Because what you're really trying to do is disprove a hypothesis. You can find things that would be supportive of whatever outcome you're looking for. If you can disprove a hypothesis, that's a stronger contribution to your analysis. That lets you know you're on the right path. And so when we looked at, why we didn't think that Guccifer 2.0 was a hacktivist, and a couple of things came out. One, his MO does not match the way hacktivists operate. They typically don't stay quiet very long. Particularly politically motivated hacktivists quickly seek publicity, dump the material that they've gained, to gain notoriety, to further their objective, to prove their point. And when Guccifer 2.0 first emerged on the scene, from his Twitter followers, he was going for a more Bernie Sanders angle as a Sanders supporter. So if you were an independent hacktivist that was supporting Bernie Sanders, the time to leak your material is not in June of 2016 after Clinton has secured the nomination. If you're finding stuff that shows that the DNC is being, not even-handed and is disadvantaging your preferred candidate, you leak that months ago when it can still have an impact on the primary that's happening in the Democratic Party. Then there are all of the many, many holes in his backstory. So as I mentioned, this is literally a WordPress site and a Twitter handle. We can't find him on any sorts of hacker forums. There's no trail from him to any other previously known operations. Journalists, when they question him in Romanian, his answers come back not at a native language level. And the journalist's advice did some really, really great work on this in terms of the linguistic analysis that looked at his sentence structure. And, you know, so Russian is a Slavic language, Romanian is a Romance language. So there are actually meaningful differences in how native speakers of those two languages would speak, would speak English. I get so excited about this. And so there's this inconsistency as well that comes throughout his interactions with the press. And then there's the tone in his posts and his interviews. Now, if you read the Guccifer 2 WordPress site, which is, you know, 15 minutes probably well spent, please do it through Tor, you'll see it's very, very clear that the tone in the posts varies so widely from one post to another. Like, this reads like it's a committee of people operating this persona, not one person. The way the English flows varies widely. The way Guccifer 2 talks about his technical prowess, which we'll dive into here in a minute, makes absolutely no sense. So all of this for us is reiterating that something's not right here. This is not an independent actor as he claims to be, that this is a mouthpiece trying to further the objectives of the Russians. Now, at this point, I have to be clear, what we thought those objectives were much more limited. We really thought at this point, because we're in late June here, we're before the big WikiLeaks dump, that the purpose of the DNC operation was espionage, and that they created this guy to distract attention as a shiny object when they got caught. And they were just leaking out sort of low-value stuff to distract attention from what had happened. So the more he talks about the breach, the less plausible it sounds. And this is the blog, if you check it out, where we actually, you know, tip our hat to Shmoocon, in that the way that he talks about his exploits would get him pelted with shmoo balls. So he talks about, in launching this attack, that he found a zero-day vulnerability in the NGP Van Vote Builder software. So NGP Van Vote Builder, which I'm guessing most of you have probably not heard of, is a very niche software as a service platform used by primarily Democratic political campaigns. So if you're an independent hacker looking to go create a vulnerability, your incentives are to create something that's going to have the broadest applicability that you're going to be able to monetize for the, you know, longest amount of time. An application like this doesn't make any sense why this would be your way in, especially when you have Fancy Bear and Cozy Bear getting in through the much simpler way of spear phishing. He talks about fuzzing and using IDA Pro and WinDBG, WinDebugger, to take, you know, to analyze the binary and develop this vulnerability. So again, you know, this is a software as a service platform. Like, there is no binary for him to do these things to. And even if he did, it wouldn't have given him the access to the servers that he would have needed in the DNC to be able to exfiltrate all that data. So none of this makes any sense. The timing also is totally off. He claims that he compromised the DNC in the summer of 2015. Using a bug that only came into production in December of 2015. And so what happened with that bug was that when the new version of NGP Van Vote Builder was released, there was a bug that allowed basically the Sanders campaign to see some additional attributes about voters they were supposed to be able to see, but the attributes had been added by the Clinton campaign and they weren't supposed to see that. And it caused a huge firestorm, as you might imagine. The campaigns at that point, in December of 2015, when the nomination is still very much an open question, you know, really came down hard on NGP Van. And so they did a full scrub of the software. They patched it very, very quickly. This wasn't a bug that was out there very long. It didn't even exist in the summer of 2015. Hence our Chuck Norris meme. Only Chuck Norris is capable of exploiting a vulnerability that doesn't exist yet. All right, so I mentioned he's also interacting with journalists. And leaking documents directly to outlets like The Smoking Gun, The Hill, and Vocative. These reporters are coming to us and sharing these interactions, one, because they want to make sure they're not getting, you know, bombed with malware from communicating with this guy, but also trying to figure out if this is a credible voice and how much attention should be paid to him. So they're sharing the email headers from his analysis and saying that he's pushing really hard for them to publish the stuff that he's giving them. But in a lot of cases, the material at this point that Guccifer 2.0 is giving to journalists is not really newsworthy. It's dated. or it's non-sensational. So he was pushing a lot of documents pertaining to campaign finance scandals from like 2005, 2006, that was already sort of publicly known, or dropping lists of donors for the Democratic Party, particularly LGBT donors. And this is stuff that is not newsworthy in the US context. But everything that he would drop would get picked up and rebroadcast through RT, through Russian propaganda channels, where those themes actually make sense in terms of the themes that Russia tries to convey to its population. So even old campaign finance scandal documents, you know, underscore dirty money in politics and how corrupt the U.S. system is. And unfortunately, there's a very virulent anti-homosexual theme right now in Russia, where that LGBT information, again, just fuels that fire in the domestic Russian context, even if it's not really having an impact at this point here on the U.S. news cycle. So all this is sort of happening in the background, and it's kind of supporting our hypothesis at that point that he's just dropping, you know, low intelligence information stuff. Whatever points they can get off of that is just gravy. But he's sharing, you know, the email analysis, or the reporters are sharing email headers with us for analysis. And that's how we're able to find his VPN. So as it turns out, Guccifer 2.0, I mentioned this French nexus kind of keeps coming back out. He had registered his Twitter account from a French IP address, which we were able to validate, and I thought this was kind of cool. Basically, when you sign up for Twitter, Twitter automatically suggests, you know, 8 or 9 accounts for you to follow right away, so you have something to consume off the feed. And that list is generated based off of the IP that you register your account from. So we went in and created some Twitter handles from other French IP addresses to see what the overlap was between, you know, Guccifer's initial set of follows and what was being recommended for us. And it was about 2/3 of the list. So we thought that was interesting. But of course, that in of itself, you know, not a compelling piece of evidence, but an interesting one nonetheless. And then he's interacting with these journalists from an AOL account. Now, I know what you're thinking. Like, what self-respecting hacker is going to use an AOL account? And it's true. Not just because even my parents think that they don't want to use AOL. But in this case, AOL gives up your originating IP address when you authenticate into their service. And in this case, no self-respecting hacker would give up their IP address and give us this little breadcrumb. You know, they'd be much more aware of which services capture that type of metadata and make it available. All right, so now we have this IP address. So a new indicator for us to go, you know, run through all of our traps, go look at the passive DNS, go look and see what else we can figure out about it. So we dig in, we start enumerating it to see what's turned on using, you know, sources like Census and Shodan. And what we find is that there's OpenSSH and point-to-point tunneling enabled on it. All right. So, and it also, that SSH fingerprint is shared with 6 other IP addresses sort of in the same block. So that told us that we were looking at proxy infrastructure, which, you know, makes perfect sense. We would assume that Guccifer 2.0 would be using some sort of proxy service to put some distance between his actual infrastructure and the rest of us. So we started by going and take a look, see if we could identify this as part of the Tor network. It was not a Tor node. And as we kept digging down, we found on one of those passive DNS hits a link to one of these VPN, it was the French one, the vpnservice.fr address. So keep digging, look at the registration records. And if you go all the way back to when this site was first stood up in 2004, you find a mail.ru registrant and links to a couple of Russian companies. So today, if you looked at this registration information, it's registered to not John Smith, but something, you know, equally as benign out of New York. And so what we found was Guccifer 2.0 was using Elite VPN, a Russian-owned VPN service. We went, we stood up an account, responsibly, to check and see, and we found that the 6 IP addresses that were publicly offered were the same IP addresses that matched that SSH fingerprint. What was interesting was that Guccifer 2.0's IP address, the one that he's using here, this, you know, 54.34, was not publicly available. But it matched the same characteristics as the ones that were, leading us to conclude that it had been cloned from those servers, but that Guccifer 2.0 had access to, you know, private infrastructure through this VPN service. So that was pretty exciting. This was, you know, sort of our first technical link for Guccifer 2.0, you know, back to Russia, even though all these other non-technical indicators had been piling up here over the course of several weeks. Before I go to the DCCC breach, something very important happens between what I just talked about and here, and that is the WikiLeaks dump. So that first really large WikiLeaks dump of thousands of emails going right into the Democratic National Convention that caused Debbie Wasserman Schultz to resign was for us really a game-changing moment in terms of what we were seeing unfold here. Because here now, we're not just talking about, you know, table scraps, you know, for propaganda purposes. Like, this is a deliberate effort to inflict major pain on a political party. And Guccifer 2.0 had said all along, like, from his first post on his WordPress site, like, through his interviews with different reporters, that he had given all this stuff to WikiLeaks, and he was complaining that they were taking too long to publish. In this case, WikiLeaks had a better sense for when that information would be sort of most damaging, you know, have the most impact by waiting to hold it until right before the convention. But when that happened for us, it was really kind of a watershed moment. We had to go back and re-examine some of those assumptions that had led us to those earlier hypotheses that this was primarily an espionage information campaign. Now this was starting to look like an active measures influence campaign. And that changes things. So right on the heels of sort of that revelation, everyone's still reeling from this first WikiLeaks set of disclosures, comes the announcement of the breach of the Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee. So this is the part of the Democratic apparatus that funds congressional races. This was research that we conducted along with Fidelis. And basically, we found a very similar pattern of using a spoof domain as part of this attack. So the legitimate domain for the DCCC is actblue.com. They registered actblues.com. And our registrant is one of these mail.com addresses, fisterbox@mail.com. Three of the other domains that had been registered by this address had been linked to Fancy Bear through other sources. The Germans had named them, so we knew something about them. The spoof domain was registered on 14 June, which, if you'll recall, was when the Washington Post article came out. So you have timing here that's consistent with an adversary that's just been kicked off of the DNC networks that's now looking to establish other ways in. And then we had an overlap with the name servers. So the name servers were the same as the ones used with that MIS department squat that we talked about a couple of slides ago. So some interesting things happening here that are, you know, good for researchers to know. In this case, the registrant information was obscured via Whois, so we had to go dig a little further. When you find records of interest that you can't get the Whois on, one place to go look is start of authority records. So by going and digging for the start of authority record was how we were able to get fisterbox@mail.com. They're not as easily accessible. There's not like a clean automated way to search it, so this is a higher touch method of getting to these answers, but when you've got something like this where you know that you want to, you know, dig deeper on this particular piece of infrastructure, that's another tool in a researcher's toolkit. So I mentioned that there was an overlap with name servers, and this was something else that was starting to come across our analysis here over the course of the summer, was that we were seeing some of these small name servers show up repeatedly being used to register Fancy Bear infrastructure. In this case, ActBlues was registered via the IT Itch name server. So this is a small name server based out of Romania with a self-declared 0% law enforcement compliance rate, accepts Bitcoin, and allows you to register your infrastructure anonymously. And so three guesses why that might be of value or of use to our friends here. I mentioned that Fisterbox had registered three other domains. These, you see them here on this Bitcoin DNS hosting name server. Same thing. You can pay with Bitcoin, you can register anonymously. So we had seen those, and they had caught our eye because they looked like a spoof of Intel Corporation. Initially, we weren't even sure that they were Fancy Bear related. And we'd gotten there because, come back. There we go. That MIS department squat that we talked about earlier off of that C2 domain was also registered using the same Bitcoin name server. So no surprise there, when we went and kind of enumerated all the other domains that were on this Bitcoin DNS hosting server, it was just acres and acres of badness. I don't think we could identify one legitimate site off of the domains that were on here. Not all of them were APT related, a lot of them were crimeware focused. But this was a nice little nugget to find where we were able to harvest a lot of indicators that might be useful for our users and our customers Because if it's coming off of here, like, we're pretty sure it's not good. And so then we were wondering if Frank Merdu had also used IT itch. And lo and behold, we found that he had. So in this case, all of the known infrastructure pertaining to these two addresses, all of those domains have been associated with Fancy Bear, and both of those handles had used both of these two name servers. So this, again, you know, when you think about how perishable individual indicators are, right, domains and IP addresses, when you're conducting this type of infrastructure analysis, you're constantly trying to sort of draw up the level to get to a point where you're understanding the adversary's tactics, techniques, and procedures, how they operate, how they stand up this infrastructure. As you start getting into those patterns, those tend to be more durable. In this case, you know, they will be able to change this, but that means that there's a lot of other breadcrumbs scattered around, you know, surrounding these patterns that we can go and look for and identify potentially new leads. So that's the DCCC breach. Initially, Guccifer 2.0 said he had nothing to do with it, and then like several weeks later on August 12th or so, just dumping documents from the DCCC breach. Like, we actually joked at the end of our blog when we wrote about the DCCC breach that, like, when does Guccifer 2.0 show up? And then like a week and a half later, he starts posting documents. So that was fun. He also showed us DC leaks. And I'll be perfectly honest, this was something that we missed at first. One of the journalists we were talking to said that Guccifer 2.0 was trying to, you know, get the journalist to publish stuff from DC leaks. And at this point, we're still trying to figure out if the guy's Romanian or not. So we'd kind of put this one on the back burner. And this journalist comes back to us and says, I really think you should check this out. Like, there's something else going on here. And so we go take a look, and the journalist from the Smoking Gun was totally right. There's all sorts of weird stuff going on here. So DC Leaks first kind of caught some headlines in June by leaking the emails of General Philip Breedlove from his personal Gmail account. Now, you're probably thinking, I know where this ends up. This ends up at Podesta. And it's basically the same attack vector. Breedlove's emails show up on DC Leaks. Breedlove was the previous four-star commander for European Command and the commander of NATO forces in Europe. So you can imagine why this is a person that the Russians would be really interested in what's in his email account. And the emails that he leaks, it's him talking to other former officials, basically trying to figure out how to get his issues, and in this case Russia, higher on the Obama administration's agenda. Like, he's complaining that he feels that there's not enough attention being focused on it. And so it's like Beltway inside baseball in terms of, you know, how things get scheduled and you know, all the different issues that compete for senior administration officials' attention. But again, that propaganda message, like, it was just, you know, it was beautiful. Look at this American general who's so anti-Russia and is agitating for a much more muscular response. And so that was the start of DC leaks. But pretty much only the really Europe-centric, you know, watchers kind of picked up on this. The rest of us were, you know, still over here trying to figure out what Guccifer's talking about. So now we pivot to this, and we're taking a look. The journalist sees that there's this password-protected content in the top left corner here of a guy named William Reinhardt, and reaches out to this guy. And so lo and behold, first we start looking at this. DC Leaks was established in April of 2016. For me personally, this was very significant in my understanding of what was happening here with this story. The fact that this was stood up in April 2016, basically along the same time frame that you've got the DNC breach unfolding for Fancy Bear and this widespread phishing campaign targeting DNC staffers, this told me that there was always the intent to at least leak some of this information for influence. And that was a point that we didn't reach in our understanding here until later in the summer. Claims to be a new level project. Again, this is a direct quote by the American hacktivists. So again, you have an example here of trying to leverage hacktivist clothing as a way to legitimize content that's being exfiltrated from APT breaches. Again, we had to go dig for start of authority records to get the feehan@europe.com handle. So we've got that pattern again with the one-on-one emails and the infrastructure that's being stood up. And we have an overlap with the name servers that are being used. So it's not the same two we talked about before, but another one. This Kata 501836 that we'd also seen used in other Fancy Bear infrastructure. So now, you know, our antennas are up. And about the same time, you've got the team at SecureWorks that publishes a really great assessment that I highly recommend reading on these spear phishing campaigns. In this case, they were looking at a campaign that had unfolded over the spring, targeting DNC staffers. And basically, the recipe was the Spearfish claimed to be, to identify suspicious login activity and requests the user to change their password. They use Bitly to shorten the malicious link so that it looks more credible to the victim, and then also paired that with the Base64 encoded string so that when the user clicked through, it populated with their name, again, making it look more credible to the victim. And so we reached out through this journalist to Billy Reinhart, and lo and behold, found an exact, the exact replica of this spear phishing email that had been used to target him. He had absolutely no idea that his inbox had been owned and that all these emails were hanging out on the DC Leaks website until he had been contacted by this journalist. So from that, we were able to get the email header. You guys can probably see where I'm going with this. And we start running the traps to see what else we can find out about it. So instead of being sent from Google Security, it's actually being sent from a Yandex account, Yandex being a free Russian webmail service. So that doesn't conclusively prove this is Russian APT, but it does say, something's off here. This is not what it claims to be. We were able to go and look at the bit.ly shortened URL and see that it was clicked once on the 20th of March and took them to a fake Google login page. Let me stay here for just a second. So this is the type of content that was starting to show up on DC Leaks, and this attack vector, particularly the spear phishing email, is one that we started to see a lot of. When we published this research, we had an inbound inquiry come in from Elliot Higgins, the founder of Bellingcat. If you're familiar with their work, they are citizen investigative journalists who've done a lot of really good work on the shootdown of MH17 over Ukraine a couple years ago and the investigation into that, as well as Russian military activity in Syria and Ukraine. So as you might imagine, if you're covering those subjects, your journalists are going to be heavily targeted by the Russian government. So we published this analysis, and he reaches out to us and says, hey, I've got one of those spear phishing campaigns. They've been targeting me like this for, almost a year. Do you guys want to take a look at it? Of course, we were ecstatic. So we get all of these new samples run through and, again, are able to draw out more, more domains, more infrastructure that's being used to launch these types of attacks and raise awareness of, this attack method that's targeting increasingly now not just political officials, but journalists, basically anybody who runs afoul of what the Russian government once said. All right. Last major piece, I got 10 minutes left. State Board of Election attacks. So now at this point, we are in August. And so all throughout this research, we're talking to journalists, we're doing lots of interviews, trying to explain, what counts and what doesn't count when you're talking about attribution. Because lots of journalists see Yandex, that means APT. It's like, nope, stop. You can't write that, that's not right. And the State Board of Election attacks, so in July and August, there was the stories coming out about Illinois and Arizona, their State Board of Elections coming under attack. This was the point for us where we felt like the press coverage was starting to tip towards hysteria. Like there were Russians around every corner, the whole fate of the electoral system was in doubt. And tell us the proof of what's happening here. And when we went, we looked at these indicators, we didn't have a strong link. And that was a very interesting set of interviews to go through with all these journalists because they were really pushing for a much stronger statement than we were willing to give them. And I remember having a conversation with our PR guys and saying, look, it's great that they want to talk to us, but we're here to tell the story, not just give them the soundbite. And if the evidence isn't there that we can link this and, stand our ground on it, we're not going to say that. That's our responsibility as researchers to be honest with the evidence. So let's talk about that evidence a little bit. So what you're looking at here is a representation of the Diamond Model. Quick show of hands, who has heard of the Diamond Model? All right. Some. More by the end of this talk. The Diamond Model is a method of intrusion analysis. It was developed in the Department of Defense. One of our co-founders is a co-author of the Diamond Model. And so this is one of the analytical approaches that undergirds Threat Connect as a platform and the work that we do on the team as researchers. And so basically what it posits is that for any intrusion, there are four interrelated elements. Starting on that left side of the diamond, you've got the capabilities that are used in an intrusion. So these are in this case, the tools that were used, Akinetic, SQL injection, Dirtbuster, the different types of malware or exploits that would be used in an attack. On the right side of the diamond, you have infrastructure that's used in the attack, those IPs and domains. So that that horizontal axis of the diamond is your technical axis of attack. So this tells you how an attack was conducted. And this is the realm that most of us working in this sector sort of live in. But there's also a vertical axis, a connection between the adversary and the victim. And this tells you why an attack happened, why this organization was targeted. And what this also does is it gives you as a researcher a way to structure the information you have, because it's always going to be incomplete, fragmentary, and probably oftentimes contradictory. That's the world that we live in. So this gives you a way to organize that information and think through what are the other pieces of the puzzle that I need to be able to tell the story here. And for us, this was the best way that we could think of to organize all of the random data bits, particularly around the State Board of Election attacks, to explain this story. So you had open source tools being used. You didn't have the fingerprint that we had in the DNC breach of, you know, custom known Russian APT malware being used against these victims. So that means something. It doesn't necessarily mean that they didn't do it, but if you're using only open source tools, that makes it harder to pin it on any actor, and that's kind of the point. And there's no reason for an adversary to use a much more sophisticated custom tool if they can get the job done with open source tools. We did see that those same three tools used in the same combination by a group that claimed credit for the breach of the World Anti-Doping Agency. So that for us was suspicious, but again, not enough to hang an attribution assessment on. Similarly, when you looked at the IP addresses, six of them were hosted by King Servers, which is a Russian owned and based hosting service. So again, like, there are legitimate Russian uses of the internet. Like, I can't just say because these IPs are owned by a Russian that it's the Russian government. The interesting thing was is that the journalists really latched onto this particular point because they were able to go and meet the founder of King Servers. So, like, there was a physical person in Russia they could finally go talk to about this. And this piece of evidence gained like so much press, and we couldn't really understand it because we were sitting here saying that this has almost, you know, this is like maybe on a scale of 1 to 100, maybe this is like 2 points towards making an attribution assessment. The New York Times article is really interesting. Like, the guy lives in Siberia, he's got like this huge like anonymous neck tattoo, and was very skeptical. Like, he mostly releases internet space to pornographers, and all of a sudden he's got the New York Times like knocking down his door wanting to know why he's hacking with the US elections. It's a pretty entertaining article. But there was something we found that was interesting here, and it's that top IP address. We found links to a Russian criminal forum historically. We found, again, sort of in that neighborhood theory of it's in a similar block of other IP addresses that show up a lot for us. But as we dug deeper, we found through passive DNS a spear phishing campaign hosted on this IP address that was used in the Arizona and the Illinois State Board of Election attacks. And so a little bit about our team. Like, we're a small team, we're like 7 people. And as we're working through this, everyone's taking different pieces and running with it, right? And so it's kind of quiet, and then all of a sudden, you know, you hear all this rejoicing. Like, high fives are being exchanged, like all sorts of ruckus is being caused in the office. And the reason is, oh, I thought this slide came out, we'll come back to that. The reason is they found the phishing kit. So the whole kit that had been deployed, by going through the different command paths, they found all the entities that had been targeted here, and this was a range of Ukrainian lawmakers, members of the Turkish ruling AK party, and a couple of German parliamentarians over a period from, I think it's about like March to June-ish. So we were able to see all the victims that had been targeted from the spear phishing kit. We've got the same attack method here of impersonating Gmail and other web-based email security services to get the victim to give up their credentials. So this for us, you know, feels and looks like the fancy bear that we know and love and have been spending so much time on over the summer. But admittedly, like, this is still really, really weird. Like, what is a spear phishing kit doing on this, you know, IP address that is also targeting our State Board of Elections? It doesn't make a ton of sense, but it was really, really interesting. And when you looked at it, the timing again here was also interesting, because over the summer, right, we had this attempted coup in Turkey. And then right after the coup, WikiLeaks did a huge dump again of AK party, the ruling party's emails. So when we looked at it circumstantially, we saw that the timing of the data content being dumped on WikiLeaks fit with the timing of this attack. We had an overlap of at least 6 emails from the WikiLeaks dump that were also on the victim list. So that to us was really interesting, again, in raising the question of how much are the Russian intelligence services using WikiLeaks to launder all of this information? Because WikiLeaks has a much, much broader reach and much more authoritative voice than Guccifer 2.0 or DC Leaks, these sort of niche outlets that, you know, the Russians might have a lot more control over but have much less reach. So we don't know. I mean, there are a lot of missing links in the intermediate parts of that chain. But I think it's something that we need to think more critically about going forward, because this seems a little too coincidental to just be coincidental. All right, so that takes us through most of the summer. The Podesta emails come out, so that's the output again of the same type of spear phishing attack technique that we've already discussed. As we look across, again, the breaching and leaking efforts, we've got fingerprints of known Russian APT threat actors identified, multiple venues that were created to leak that data, and victim sets that are pretty consistent with their known targeting focus. Or, too long didn't read. I saw this online last week. I watched it a dozen times, and I still think it's hilarious. I'm also really grateful that I get to come present this at venues like Shmoocon, where you guys will appreciate it too. All right. So, some of our conclusions. What was going on here? You know, the worst case scenario that was being debated all throughout the course of this is that we were looking at an active attempt to interfere with our ability to hold a credible election. And the scary part was, like, there is precedent for this. If you look at what the Russians did in Ukraine in 2014, you had APT-20, Fancy Bear malware, show up on the Central Election Commission servers, take down the Central Election Commission several days before the vote was scheduled to happen. So if they had not been able to bring that back up, their ability to hold and tally votes on the day of the election would have been severely degraded. Similarly, in that Ukraine case, on the night of the election, the Ukrainians discovered malware that would have altered the projected winner and portrayed a ultra-right nationalist as the victor with like 30% of the vote, when in reality the guy got like less than 10. And again, if you follow sort of these themes and the way this conflict has unfolded between Russia and Ukraine, Russia portrays Ukraine's resistance to Russia carving up their country as ultra-nationalist, neo-Nazi motivated. So again, really much that would have fanned the flames, even though the Ukrainian government would have been able to walk back and say, no, here's what really happened. They caught that before it went live. So there was a precedent here, and that was the scariest outcome, the worst case scenario. And you know, all the articles that we read over the fall about the integrity of our election systems and how hackable were they, I think stemmed from a fear that this could be what we were looking at. That did not happen. We have no evidence at this point that, you know, that the Russians hacked individual election systems or tried to alter vote counts. However, what we certainly did see was a willingness to damage individual politicians by leaking a lot of embarrassing data. And one of the things that seemed new about this campaign was their willingness just to dump tons of personal information that had absolutely no relevance to the political story or objective they were trying to achieve. And so we saw this not only you know, with the email dumps on DC Leaks, but again, the work that we've done with some of these reporters, where when they dump this information, they are going after, there's an active intent to intimidate, right, by leaking personal, embarrassing information that has nothing to do with your work. So in the case of that journalist, not only, you know, were they looking for his sources and what stories he was covering and his travel plans, but they also basically daisy-chained his accounts together once they got into his email, since that was his recovery account, got into his iCloud account, you know, dumped pictures, information about his dating and sexual preferences, like just being mean, right? There's a nastiness to this that is different from a lot of the ways that we've seen particularly traditional state-backed attacks play out, right? Like, there used to be rules about this sort of thing. And that's not what we're seeing with these types of leaks. There's definitely, I think, an effort to undermine our faith as Americans in our government process and in our leaders, to throw sand in the gears by making us question and undermine the legitimacy of whoever was elected. And you know, this was an effort, but I don't want to overstate it, because when you look at propaganda, you know, one of the rules of thumb for propaganda is that the best propaganda is one that your audience is inclined to believe. And so when you think about it, there was a lot there that we had already sort of done to ourselves in terms of questioning the quality of our leaders, you know, the fairness of some of these institutions. They are just exploiting that on top of it. And then finally, to amplify those messages domestically for a Russian audience. Super uplifting, I know. I'm getting the stop signs. I've got to move these last two really quickly. How'd they do it? Breaching and leaking. Will this continue? Absolutely. You know, no matter how much I think the Russians look at, like, oh, were we super successful, there's absolutely no reason for them to stop based on what we've seen this year, right? Either the pushback or, you know, the questions about the efficacy of the method, like, that's not really there in that cost-benefit equation. And you've got some really sensitive elections coming up in Europe this year, in France and Germany, so stay tuned. You're going to see these same types of tactics, we believe, play out again. And finally, value of good analytic tradecraft. I can't stress enough how important this is to our work as researchers. There were so many opportunities over the course of this summer and this research for us to, you know, just fall flat on our faces and really embarrass ourselves by making unfounded leaps or not being honest with the quality of the evidence. So I've talked about a number of techniques that are useful for researchers. We've talked about some of the strategic context that's useful. And then as well, just to highlight again the importance of information sharing. We would have run out of indicators to work on by the last week of June had it not been for working with all these different journalists who kept giving us new leads that we could digest and grow that graph and expand the network of things that we understood. And that's, you know, the adversary counts on the fact that we don't talk amongst ourselves to share this information. So obviously doing that is an important way forward. If you're interested in learning more, all of this is published at length with lots of technical details on our blog, going back from June all the way through September. And that's it. Sign up for a free account if you want to see how those indicators are modeled. And I got t-shirts. Our award-winning Black Hat 2016 Chewbacca Incident Responder t-shirt. Come get them. I don't want to take them back to the office. So thank you, and I think we have a couple minutes for questions.